Right, so we are now ready for Dire Straits. Okay, so the last part of the class of today is called the Dire Straits time. So, I already discussed it at the beginning. This is the time it takes to escape through narrow passages. So, we ask the following question. Suppose you have an ensemble of obstacles, and they are big enough, and you look at the domain defined here by the four discs. And those obstacles, they are impenetrable. Nothing can enter. Nothing can enter into this obstacles, and you start with a Brownian particle. And now you ask how long it takes to escape to find one of the four ends that are there. Right? How long it takes to escape. And this is a model to coarse grain diffusion on the membrane of a cell, like a neuronal cell. Because diffusion, what do you see under the microscope? Under the microscope, you might see this. Due to the coarse grain resolution of the microscope. So you see this, and what your algorithm is doing, if you have, is going to connect the dots, and this is going to be your trajectory. Now this has nothing to do with the, I mean, you can ask, what is the connection between what you are seeing and the reality? For this, you need a model, because you don't see the obstacles. However, you know that at a very short scale, you have the Brownian motion, which is given by a certain diffusion coefficient. And if you wait sufficiently long enough, which is the time it takes to escape from this, that's what I'm going to calculate, you get a coarse grain motion, which is a jump process to the neighbors. It can only escape in the full one, assuming that they are organized in a square lattice. And so then you have a jump process. So you have this square. So you have an ensemble of square. And now what we are really doing here is a cross-graining. We cross-grain the motion as a jump process between the different squares, which is what you get from your experiments. If you are taking a delta t, a time for sampling, which is long enough, and then you are back to a certain diffusion process, but now you are interested in asking how this diffusion, effective diffusion, depends on the density of obstacles, and especially these passages. Because if it is very narrow, then the time is going to be very long between all those jumps. And if it is like this, you can show that you can recourse grain everything as a continuous diffusion process with an effective diffusion coefficient that we can calculate from the escape time to this particular region. That's what the motivation when we started all of this about 6-7 years ago. And why we did this? Because escaping from a cusp is not as simple as escaping from a regular part, as we're going to see now. And so as a generic question for this, we said, now look at this. Suppose you have a domain with a cusp. So the generic domain is going to be this one. Take two discs. This is the x-axis. This is the y-axis. And let's take our domain which is following exactly the cusp, and then it can be here big domain, whatever it is, we don't care. And now we ask the question, how long it takes to escape this domain, which means that we start at position x here, you have again Brownian motion, and you want to know how long it will take to me to hit for the first time the blue arc of length epsilon. Right? This is the question. Now, how do you solve this? We have already formulated the problem three times. Now we have to solve the PDE with a cusp. Now this becomes non-trivial. So it took us a couple of years to see that how are we going to address this question. I mean, again, we are not interested in showing that it goes to infinity. It's clear that it's going to infinity. So now we have two new parameters. I mean, an additional new parameter, which is the radius of curvature, r. R is the radius of curvature of this that is approximating here your funnel. The curvature radius. Okay, and now we need to, so again, I think diffusion coefficient equals 1. So we are left with the equation of epsilon equal minus 1. U equals 0 on the arc. Let's call it absorbing. And then du dn equals 0 on the reflecting part. And so, how we solve this question? So, what is the Green's function with a cusp? We don't know. So, in some sense, you need to find out a way to get rid of the singularity in the domain and to put it in the equation. So now we started in dimension 2. Dimension 3, it's also possible if you have enough symmetry. So how do you do this? What we did is basically I'll give you the idea before we start. What is the boundary layer? Boundary layer is the place where the time depends on the position. The boundary layer is exactly in this funnel. While if you start, this is called the boundary layer. That is really, you can see the dependency of the position. While if you start anywhere here, basically it doesn't matter where you started. And so the idea is that there is a very specific new type of boundary layer analysis here, because how are we going to resolve this? So the idea was to stretch the boundary layer, and this region is unimportant. So for this, we use what is called Möbius conformal mapping transformation, which is a transformation which is well known in complex variable, which is z minus alpha divided by minus alpha z, where alpha, I will explain in a second, which is a real parameter, I will explain in a second what it is. Why using this? So this is now, let's say, a ball of radius 1. And z is, so this is x and y. So z is x plus I, y. So yeah, and it is shifted, so I'm sorry, this is the y for this transformation. So this is a disk center at zero. Now the idea of the Möbius transformation is whatever is outside goes inside. And now I'm not going to show it, I mean to show the detail, but now if you have a complex variable, you can ask where this little arc is going to be mapped. So you have a conformal mapping, right, that will map this somewhere, and this, all of this length here somewhere. So this will tell us where all of this domain is going to be mapped. So again, you can do it, or you can do it in MATLAB, or just by... So for example, what is the image of something real by a complex function that is where alpha is real? This, by definition, is going to be real again. Yeah, because if it's real, real, everything is real. So I'm telling you that now this is going to be, so this point here, minus one, is actually an invariant point. So actually, this is going to be mapped here. This part here is going to be mapped, because it's on the circle, what is in the circle stay in the circle, right? You know how to, I mean, you understand what I'm saying, or this is completely different language? So for example, if you take the z equals I theta, this is the, so if you plot that into here, so let's show that this is on the circle. How do you show this? We have to prove that the modulus is 1. So how do you do this? This is I theta minus alpha divided by 1 minus alpha multiplied by I theta, correct? But this, now you can just divide. I mean, this is also I theta minus alpha divided by 1 minus alpha. And I put the I minus I theta, and now I have to put here I theta, correct? I didn't change anything. Now this is absolute value, so this is 1. This divided by this is 1, so this is 1. So what is on the disk is sent or something that is on the disk. I mean on the surface. You're with me? I mean, this is elementary, right? I just take this, a point z, which is on this disk of radius 1, and this function, which is phi of I theta, absolute value, which is equal to this, which is equal to this, it's going to be 1, 2. Oh, this is on the disk. Okay. So this, which is on the disk, will stay on the disk, but not at this position. It is inverted. So it will go to here. And then you can continue. And this, at some point, will go like this. And then when you end up in here, this that was mapped in here, you have to continue through this, so you have something parallel. And this is mapped into this domain. So the entire domain here is mapped on the domain. And the size of this, if this is of size epsilon, this is of size epsilon, or 2 epsilon, I always forget. This is the size of this domain. You want me to enlarge a little bit so that we see? Again, it took us some time to do all this mapping. So the domain is mapped into this. And this is of size square root epsilon. Now this is great. Why it's great? Because when epsilon goes to zero, the domain converges to something which is like a line, which is like dimension 1. Although we started with full dimension 2, it's not becoming dimension 1. So that's the idea behind this calculation. Now, how do we do the rest? The rest is not very hard. So again, I'll give you references for this. We have this, and now it's very easy to continue. We just make a change of variable, and to transport the equation u, that was the u of z, into an equation of v of w in this domain, which is the domain in the complex plane of w. W, which is phi of z. So we have u of z, which is v of w. So now we have to write the equation for v. And so the equation for V is usually, so this is a classical conformal mapping that you plug into the Laplacian. This will give you phi prime of V squared, Laplacian of V of W, that is should be equal to minus 1, right? So this is, again, just take Laplacian u of v and you have to compose it. So you have the second derivative that comes. So this is a classical formula. And now we need to calculate phi prime of z, so we need to differentiate this with respect to z. Okay, so you can do the calculation, it's trivial, I just did it before. Coming, phi prime of z is equal to 1 minus alpha squared divided by 1 minus alpha z squared. And now we need to express everything in W, because we need to be everything. So then we need to invert this W equals Z minus D. So we need to express Z as a function of W, put that in here. And the result is 1 plus alpha omega divided by 1 minus alpha squared. And now we need to put this squared. And now we have an equation in this domain, which is Laplacian V. So I'll give you the result. There is one more thing I have to tell you. To be able to do this, the alpha has to be very precise. And alpha is actually a perturbation of epsilon. This is 1 minus square root of epsilon. And so, when you have this, you have to write another equation, which is this one. So I divide this by this factor that I've calculated here. And so you ended up with minus 4 epsilon divided by, so d equals 1, omega 1 minus square root epsilon minus 1 to the power 4. And v, this is sent to this, so v of 0, v equals 0, v equals 0 on this part here, this on the image, let's call it phi of the omega a, and otherwise dvdn equals 0. This is the reflecting boundary condition. Now what have we done? And omega here, this is the omega, which is a complex variable in this plan. This is the variable omega. Let's call omega, for example, capital X plus IY. This is X and this is Y. Now I wanted to finish today, but I'm not going to finish. Okay, so now what have we win? Why we did all of this? Why? For one reason. Now, the boundary layer is all of this, but this is almost one-dimensional. So if it is almost one-dimensional, let's be brutal. This is in the variable x and y. This is really a partial differential equation. When epsilon is very small, this is very narrow. This is almost a partial differential equation on one line with some curvature. So this, how do you write Laplacian in polar coordinate? This is d dv dr squared plus 1 over r d dv d r plus 1 over r squared d dv d theta. But if v as a function of r, the variation, the change in r, is negligible, we're just going to assume that at first order it is a function just of theta. And this x plus y can be written r and theta, which is the notation I have used for this. So This is for r almost equal 1. And theta would be the only variable. So if it is independent of r, this is 0, this is 0. And r is almost 1. So we are left with the second order equation in theta, which is trivial to integrate because we have this in here, equal this. Well, this is 9 minus epsilon. Omega is what? It's going to be I theta, because r is about 1. 1 minus square root epsilon minus 1 to the power 4. Now you can integrate this. Once you understand correct transformation, the problem is not how. How do you integrate this? You integrate it once. So we're going to integrate it. This is dv theta. Let's integrate it from the position theta, position phi, to the end. Okay, now we have to understand what is the end. What is this angle here? Because now we're integrating in the angle. So this is the end angle. So this is basically somewhere like capturing the end. So for this, it turned out that this angle, and this we have to do some calculation for this. This angle is of the order a constant square root epsilon. This is the maximum angle that you can go. Theta max. And so this is, so we integrate this. And the idea, of course, is at this point, since the particle is reflected, so this is dv this theta minus dv this theta at c square root epsilon equals theta c square root epsilon of this, which is minus 4 epsilon exponential I u 1 minus square root epsilon minus 1 power 4 du. Now what is this equal to? This, what happened, a particle at this point here, all particles are reflected. So the mean first passage time, the derivative of the mean first passage should be 0. And now we have to integrate one more time to get v as a function of theta. Now we know by definition that when a particle hit this part here, which is equivalent to this one, it is absorbed. So v theta minus v zero, and this is by definition zero, this is the integration from zero to theta of c square root epsilon to, let's say, phi minus 4 epsilon d u exponential I u 1 minus square root epsilon minus 1 to power 4 du d phi. And this is 0. So this is the solution. Okay, so now we need to calculate what? What do we need to calculate? We need to calculate the mean first passage time when the particles start anywhere here, because we say it is constant. And this part here is exactly this part here. So this is sent to here. And this we have to take for theta. Let's say something of this order. So now we need to calculate and then we stop. So we need to calculate, so next week we calculate v of c square root epsilon, which is integral from 0 to c square root epsilon. So with the minus, if I didn't make a mistake, let's rotate, so this is now integral from phi to c square root epsilon of epsilon du d phi exponential I u 1 minus square root epsilon minus 1. It's calculations. But mathematics is about calculations, nothing else.
and how to do them and how to do them right. If it's impossible, we can simulate. This is trivial now. Once we understood the ideas of this conformal mapping and the fact that how you choose alpha and understand that the domain now can be reduced to dimension one, so you can now integrate. And there are succession of ideas that allows us to calculate. And this idea works in dimension three when we have symmetries, but it's a bit more complicated. Okay, to finish, there is more calculations. Maybe we'll finish next week. If you are interested, the way to do the calculation now, we need to change the order of integration. I'm not going to do it, it's very easy. You know, you just look at when phi is going, when u is going from phi to this, you have to see what u is doing. So I'll give you the results. So this is 4 epsilon d, so this is, call it v of c square root epsilon. This is c square root epsilon I, and this is pi minus eta divided by exponential I eta minus 1 minus I eta square root epsilon to power 4. Now, we are done if we know how to calculate this integral. Now, where is the problem? The problem is C. C is something that we don't know what it is. At the constant, this is the order of magnitude at which we have this angle. So we need to connect, as we did before. You remember there was this notion of compatibility condition, which came by integrating the equation. And this is the same, integrating the equation, we have Laplace and u equal minus 1, you remember? And we did it at least 3 or 4 times. We integrated this. And this gave du dn equals minus omega, you remember? And this is the same here. Now du dn over this, if du dn is almost constant, as we said before, we get du dn multiplied by the length of this, this is about, let's say, epsilon, equals minus omega. So basically there is some information here. And now we have to connect this calculation, which is done in this plane, to the derivative of the normal derivative in that plane, which is not too hard because we have exactly the connection. The connection is written somewhere. Yeah, here. U of z equals this. So if you differentiate u with respect to a variable, we have to see this is dv with respect to this variable, which is dv d omega. D omega, this variable, just combine. And this will allow to get C. So I want to stop now because I want to discuss and then I have to go. But I'll give you the results and we will finalize it next week, all right? Here is the result that you have to think for tonight and the night after. Okay, the final results. So next week, we are going to calculate this integral by cutting into 2, because you have pi here and minus, so we're going to cut into 2 and see what happens when epsilon goes to 0, to the limit. And C depends on the constant C that we will connect. But the result is the following. The mean first passage time in dimension 2 is pi omega divided by d. And if we have the curvature radius, this is square root of r, and we have square root of epsilon. R is the curvature, omega is the volume of the entire, epsilon here, this is the size of the opening. This is a leading order term. Mean first passage time in dimension 2 in a cusp is not anymore log. It's 1 over square root epsilon. It's much longer if you want to escape through a cusp. I'll finish with an open problem. What happened here if it's not a cusp? of order 2. Order 2 means approximated by a disk, but let's say of order 3, like the local expansion is y instead of being ax squared. Now suppose this is x cubed or any power. How does that change? We don't know. We did it on the surface in dimension 2, but not here. Because the fact that you map conformally the disk is very important to maintain the structure. Otherwise, there's all kind of problem inside. I can give 20 euros for this question. I think a little bit more. I can give about 200 euros. Because we don't know how to solve it. Okay, next week we'll work on this. And if you have a free weekend, you can think about solving this for general cusp. Right, next week I will prove this. I will prove this, and that will end our mathematical part of the class. And next week we will go except for this to more application to biology, super resolution data analysis, deconvolution, model of aggregation with finite number of particles, and so on.